Well, thank you all so much. My name is Evgeni Tevelev. I'm a professor at UMass Amherst. Here I'll be based in Catholica. And it's always kind of challenging, but also exciting for me to your mathematics to a general audience, because most people are familiar with work maybe of applied mathematicians who use algorithms and structures developed by pure mathematicians and adapt them sort of as an interface to other fields of sciences, both natural sciences and social sciences. You know, but in pure mathematics, we kind of focus on you know, these abstract structures themselves, right? And so the main goal of the project is to kind of assemble a large team based in Catholica to tackle some of the foundational problems in algebraic geometry, which is one of the areas of pure mathematics. Next slide. Right. So yeah. So this is the team that we are bringing together. So. So the principal investigators are myself and Giancarlo Urzua, who's a professor at Cattolica. So Giancarlo actually graduated from University of Michigan on a grant from Fulbright and Conisit, so it's a bit of a kind of Fulbright family here. Yeah, and that's us hiking in the Andes. And I'm bringing two of my graduate students with me, Sebastian Torres and Ari Stern. So that's them hiking in Massachusetts. But they actually got their master's from Cattolica, and then they came to the United States to work with me. Because actually Giancarlo, after he got his PhD at Michigan, he worked with me and, in Amherst for 3 years as, doing his postdoctoral studies. Yeah, and then, you know, he sent these two students my way, and they are both about to graduate. So this is their final year. And so I think it's great that they will share some of the things they learned back here in Cattolica. And those are the students of current students of Giancarlo. So some of them are master students, some of them are PhD students. And so, you know, so that's the team you know, that will work here on our research projects and also on a class I'll be teaching, which I'll be talking about. Yeah, and I think like mathematics has this kind of a pop cultural image of something that of this kind of solitary mathematician, you know, working on his own. Some may be a little bit crazy, but in fact, it's a you know, research in mathematics is done collaboratively, you know, by people basically just talking nonstop and you know, passing some of the things accumulated over you know, centuries or maybe millennia of mathematics. Sort of down the generations, so I think it's have this kind of educational aspect of just sort of teaching pure mathematics to kind of a lot of people who will then go on and teach it to other people, including you know computer scientists, applied mathematicians, etc. So it's a bit of like a tip of an iceberg in mathematics. Okay. So yeah, so this is the next slide, please. So those are, you know, some of the activities and the infrastructure, you know, that will be created here. And I have to say that I will stay here for a year, and so some of these activities, they kind of fall outside of the Fulbright, this 4 months window, but I still think about them sort of being parts of the same big project. You know, so we'll have a weekly seminar here for the sort of members of the group and also mathematicians interested in algebraic geometry, both in Pontifica and Cattolica, and also University of Chile. I will be teaching a graduate course on moduli spaces in algebraic geometry, which is sort of my field of expertise. And I will be teaching it in English twice a week, but then you know, my graduate students will teach orientantes in Espanol. So I think it's important for students to understand terminology in both languages, especially because you know, Cattolica, Department of Mathematics in Cattolica and Statistics is very famous for its master's program, you know, which sends a lot of students to pursue PhD studies in the United States. And I think it's, you know, I hope to kind of help give them this kind of push to pursue their studies in the most successful and efficient way in the United States. So I will also be, you know, working, you know, with a graduate program, with folks who run graduate program at Catholica on the enhancement of the program. I have some experience. I worked for 5 years at the graduate admissions in UMass Amherst, sort of working on sort of increasing diversity in mathematical sciences and you know, these kind of things. I hope I'll be able to share some of that experience with folks in Catholica, but also learn from them, you know, about how they run the show here. I will be lecturing at you know, at other universities in Argentina, in Chile. I forgot to say that, you know, one of the big kind of parts of this project will be a big graduate school and workshop conference, you know, that will take place during the first 2 weeks of December in Talca, in Chile. So ELGA workshops, I think, is the biggest event in algebraic geometry in Latin America. So they've been rotating for a while in different countries. There was one in Mexico, one in Brazil, one in Argentina. And this is the first time it will be, it will happen in Chile. So typically, you know, these workshops involve about 100 graduate students, both master's and PhD students, from all over, you know, Latin America. I also actually just heard from NSF, National Science Foundation, last week that, you know, they supported my grant application to bring about 12 graduate students from the United States to participate in this workshop.
Congratulations.
Yeah, I think it will be very neat and will increase opportunity for networking students. Sort of, I will give an outreach lecture at Taller Razonamiento Matematico, which is sort of a place where high school students in Santiago area are introduced to modern mathematics. It's happening for a while now. And the last thing, you know, I have this sort of second area of expertise, you know, where I taught twice a course on geometry of pre-Columbian textiles, and so I sort of like to collect material both on sort of pre-Columbian textiles and also modern Andean textiles. So, learn how to weave in Perus. I spent about 6 months learning this, and I try not to spend too much time on that because I have other things to think about. But I mean, that certainly is sort of this was started as a hobby, but then became my kind of big passion. It's the geometry of Andean textiles. Okay, so maybe next slide. You know, so let me say a few words about my graduate course. And this is a course on moduli space. And what is a moduli space, also known as a configuration space? Well, it's a space that parameterizes or kind of plots all geometric objects, you know, of some sort. And so here is an example. I took something from sort of a high school geometry because I met another graduate student recently who's been struggling in his courses, in mathematical courses. And I asked him, well, you know, let's go back in time and let me ask you, you know, what got you interested in mathematics in the first place? And he said, well, I mean, we didn't really have a lot of mathematics in high school, but I was really curious about triangles. You know, there are all these different types of triangles, you know, equilateral triangles, isosceles triangles, right triangles. And you can laugh at it, or if you're a mathematician, you know, you treat everything as an opportunity to find some interesting structure, interesting mathematics in it. And so what was the student was kind of secretly thinking about, he was thinking about the moduli space of all triangles, right? Because you can determine a triangle by its sides, you know, which have some restrictions. They have to be positive numbers, of course, you know, being lengths of size, but also there is this kind of a non-trivial, what's called a triangle inequality, which says that any side in the triangle is less than the sum of the other two. And so, you know, if you just, you know, plot all possible x, y's, and z's, which can be sides of a triangle, you get this picture of a kind of a cone sticking out of the origin in a three-dimensional space, and sort of points of this cone, they parameterize all sorts of different possible triangles, you know, all these isosceles and acute and right triangles that this student was so excited about. You know, and of course, you know, plotting things is something that we do a lot in applications of mathematics. You know, we can plot countries by their GDP and the population. But what's kind of novel here is, what's kind of different in mathematics is that the objects you're parameterizing, triangles in this case, and the moduli space, are both of mathematical structures, right? They're both is kind of a geometric spaces, you know, which doesn't happen very often in applications of mathematics. So maybe next slide. Right, and so, you know, so we can sort of understand objects by sort of studying this moduli space of, you know, all possible objects. You know, and of course, you know, the course, you know, won't study triangles. I probably wouldn't get a Fulbright for that, but yeah, but we will study sort of moduli spaces of sort of more complicated geometric objects, which are called algebraic varieties. And so those are this kind of the bread and butter of algebraic geometry. Right, so maybe next slide. Yeah, so these are some of the examples of geometric objects that we actually study. So they're called algebraic surfaces. So they're given not by some linear inequalities, by much more complicated equations of high degree, which look really neat if you kind of plot them and look at them. You know, but what we try to understand is kind of geometry of these objects as you kind of vary these coefficients, you know, how they will kind of deform and change their shape. And yeah, and so all sorts of interesting geometric information of this type that one can extract. Yeah, so you know, so what's algebraic geometry? Well, so algebraic geometry is kind of a language. It's a language, it's an algebraic language which we can use to describe and analyze geometric shapes. But it also works in the other way around because it allows us to kind of visualize numbers, equations, symmetries, and to gain further information from these observations. And it's one of the central areas in pure mathematics. It has a lot of applications, you know, ranging from physics to statistics. It's highly visible research, you know, so the mathematicians don't get Nobel Prizes, they get Fields Medals, and research in algebraic geometry is, of course, acknowledged by Fields Medals in practically every single sort of award cycle, you know, which I think explains some of the interest that young people have in studying algebraic geometry. So it's kind of really a central field, and it's very exciting to do research in it. So we will have this algebraic geometry seminar, you know, which will involve, you know, sort of, which will kind of center at our group, but will involve, of course, you know, the whole research group in arithmetic and algebraic geometry in Católica, as well as other universities in Santiago area, mostly University of Chile. And also two of my kind of other collaborators will spend about 2 weeks in Santiago contributing to the seminar and, you know, do research with us and students. Yeah, so let me give you an example of sort of a structure that we are kind of studying. You know, so we like to say in algebraic geometry that it sort of started in 1848, you know, when British mathematicians, you know, Kelly and Salmon proved that every cubic surface, which is sort of some special type of a surface, contains exactly 27 lines, you know, so not 26, not 28, but exactly 27. And it's a really beautiful shape that was an inspiration not just for mathematicians, but also for artists, you know, for example, you know, Barbara Kepworth, one of my favorite British sculptors, you know, try to kind of understand from the artistic point of view, you know, how lines can kind of fill the, you know, this kind of surface. You know, but, you know, but in mathematics, sort of foundations, maybe next slide, you know, foundations to this kind of modern algebraic tools, you know, that we used, were kind of due to another one of my personal heroes, you know, to Amy Noether, you know, who with her students in the 30s kind of really developed the whole school of algebra, commutative algebra, algebraic geometry that we all use nowadays in our studies. And I think like this quote by Albert Einstein from her obituary in New York Times really captures sort of the essence of what we think about being sort of researching pure mathematics. And what the quote says is that in the realm of algebra, in which the most gifted mathematicians have been busy for centuries, you know, she discovered methods which have proved of enormous importance in the development of the present-day younger generation of mathematicians. Pure mathematics is, in its way, you know, the poetry of logical ideas. And in this effort towards logical beauty, spiritual formula are developed, are discovered necessary for the deeper penetration into the laws of nature. So I really like this quote, and that's sort of the guiding principle for, I think, for us and for research in pure mathematics. And that's just one example of how this kind of conceptual thinking that Amy Noether brought to the subject kind of blows it up. You know, so you may ask, well, why surfaces? Surfaces are kind of two-dimensional, and the world we live in is three-dimensional. So, but in mathematics, we have this kind of a secret concept called complexification, you know, which involves working with complex numbers instead of real numbers. And if you do that, all the dimensions multiply by two, you know, and so this cubic surface, you know, which looks two-dimensional to us, in fact, secretly, is a four-dimensional world, you know, just like our space is, because in our space we have three spatial dimensions and one temporal dimension. And the curvature of the surface from this Barbara Hepworth sculpture is actually captures pretty well the curvature of our space-time continuum, as explained by Einstein, you know, his special relativity theory. And these little lines that the cubic surface has, in fact, secretly are not lines at all, they are spheres. You know, so in this four-dimensional world, you have these 27, you know, floating spheres, you know, which kind of is a bridge to one of the applications of algebraic geometry in physics called the string theory, you know, where, you know, these floating spheres become what's called the worksheets, you know, which describe propagation of strings, you know, which is sort of the modern mathematical point of view on moving particles. Okay, and so, yeah, so this is this this school, this is the fourth, it will be the fourth, you know, Latin American school in algebraic geometry, so we're hopefully all students attending my class will go to in December. Yeah, so, you know, so the scientific committee includes a lot of famous people from Latin America, Carolina Araujo, Michelle Artebani, who is Chilean, Alicia Dickenstein, who is from Argentina. And, you know, we are bringing speakers from the United States and from Europe, you know, to deliver courses on a variety of topics on algebraic geometry. And each course will include 2 hours of recitations led by advanced graduate students, many of them American. Yeah, and it's not just a workshop. There will also be talks by, you know, a combination of senior and junior researchers. Intended to give a panoramic view of algebraic geometry and related subjects, you know, and so we expect more than 100 participants. In fact, I think more now that we have this National Science Foundation grant, you know, from Latin America and the United States. Okay, and just to finish, you know, so this is a little bit of why I'm interested in pre-Columbian textiles, you know, so we kind of understand the hidden geometry of a cubic surface, you know, pretty well. You know, so this is a graph which describes a mathematical structure called E6, you know, which is a structure behind these 27 lines on the cubic surface. You know, but then we have similarly beautiful pictures. For example, this is, you know, one of my favorite Paracas mantles, or mantles with shamans. Mm-hmm. You know, and you know, there is, you know, once you start to study it and look at it, you know, there is a lot of geometry that's goes on, you know, sort of behind it. And you know, and that's sort of one of the things that I try to understand in my spare time mostly, but I did teach 2 classes on that already, so it's, yeah, and, you know, and that's something that we try to understand. And so maybe the last slide. Yeah, so I will continue to collect and analyze material, you know, for this course, you know, that I taught at UMass, where we explore this heritage of Andean cultures, you know, through the prism of geometry, because that's what I understand best. You know, but here we thought to think about geometry as an abstraction, not just of a physical kind of a space-time continuum, but also this kind of other types of spaces, you know, this, you know, physical, cultural, societal, technological, spiritual, artistic environments. And if you like these pictures, you can find a lot of them on the Instagram feed, which I have just explaining kind of geometry of pre-Columbian textiles specifically. So if you're curious about that, you can read a little bit about it.